Welcome gamers, welcome Z-heads. This is tutorial number 4 of Dawn of the Zeds 3rd edition. This time we're moving from level 1 to level 2 Apocalypse. This will include all the green cards, 4 new characters, 3 new heroic civilians, new fate cards and new event cards. Chaos, villages and refugees, the National Guard, rangers, raiders, VIP survivors, barricades, strong points, minefields, and perhaps a collapsed Farmingdale bridge. For the card setup, shuffle together the new characters, the green ones with the blue ones, before selecting the characters you're gonna play with. Shuffle together the green heroic civilians with the blue heroic civilians before you select your random civilian for the start of the game. Shuffle together the blue and the green fate cards for a new fate deck. Then sort the green event cards by act 1, 2, 3, 4, that's the stars on the upper left side. There's a special event card for each of the acts 2, 3, and 4, and also another end card. The card count will be different to level 1, so let's go through it. Randomly select one end card. Shuffle together the act 4 cards. Take two of these, shuffle in both of the special event cards, add them to the deck. Shuffle together Act 3 event cards, take 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, add the two special event cards, shuffle them, put them on top of the deck. Shuffle together the green and blue Act 2 cards. Take 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Randomly select only one of the Act 2 special event cards. Shuffle them in. Put them on top of the deck. Shuffle Act 1. Select two, put them on top of the deck. Then we have the National Guards. They will be the 10th card from the bottom. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 cards from the bottom. Put the National Guards on top of it. That's the event deck. This is the event deck for a co-op game. The event deck for a solo game is a bit different. You'll find that in the setup rulebook, as well as the setup for longer and even more longer games. Here's the setup as we already know it from the previous levels. All the heroes and the heroic civilians are in town center. The players got their action markers. The characters got their character ability markers, if they have any. If you got Colonel Kingman, add the strong point marker and the minefield marker. Then we have the civilians with the defiant marker randomly placed on the villages and one randomly placed in town center. A random Zeds unit at the start of any space. Play actions marker on the start space. Infection marker on the start space. Then, I just want to repeat this, roll for supplies, roll two dice, six, so it's six supplies. Take the lower die, subtract it from 6, so 6 minus 1 is 5. That's 5 ammunition. Now in addition, prepare 10 chaos markers. Put them somewhere near the board, or if you want to, somewhere on the board. That's 10 chaos markers. Next, add the equip refugees action marker to the refugee camp and place the 5 villagers on the village spaces. They're all the same, so you don't have to distribute them randomly. They are villagers when the counter is on their defiant side. Once they flip over, they are called refugees and they are fleeing. Also, you want to have the National Guard marker, rangers, raiders, and the VIP survivors, the bridge marker, and some barricades nearby. Maybe you need them. There are also some help cards for villagers, and on the back, the refugee side, raiders side, National Guard, VIP survivors, and rangers. Now let's start with chaos. There are 10 chaos markers in this level. In a later level there will be more, but in this and the next level it will be 10 chaos markers, and they will be placed on named spaces mainly. There will be a new loss condition. As soon as you have to place chaos marker and you don't have one anymore, so 10 on the board and you have to place an 11th one, you lost the game. Farmingdale just sunk in chaos and is not worth saving anymore. So take care of your chaos markers. How is chaos added? Chaos is added when a Zed's unit moves into a named space and stay there, so it doesn't retreat. Then, at the end of its movement, a chaos marker is placed. Unless there is already one. So the general rule is only one chaos marker per place. There are cards that can change it, so you can have more. But with this procedure, a maximum of one. Also, let's say we have this situation. Let's put these aside for a moment. These are already damaged with 2 hits. The Zed's unit is here. The forest track is activated. The Zed's unit moves in here, fights the civilians. The civilians, let's say, take 1 damage and have to retreat. So the Zed's unit ended its movement in an empty space. This adds a chaos marker. You never place chaos markers on start spaces of the tracks. There's a new term we have to introduce, that is Zed's controlled. All spaces with Zed's units are Zed's controlled, as well as all places with chaos marker. They don't necessarily have to be Zed's unit in there. This space is Zed's controlled. This is Zed's controlled. This is Zed's controlled too. With chaos, the outbreak procedure changes. Remember, let's say the infection is at 9. We draw an event card. We'll start with a 4R phase. I'll explain that later, but starting with level 2, we'll use all the phases. But in the infection phase, when there are 2 dice, you have to roll. And if they are equal or lower than the current infection level, reduce infection level by that amount. So, by 7 in this case, draw a fate card and check where the outbreak takes place. Where on the mountain track? Now, since we have chaos, priority are chaos spaces. So, the outbreak takes place on the closest chaos space, which would be here. So, a new Zed's unit will be placed here, instead of the closest village space. Only if there are no chaos spaces, sorry, this side of course, only if there are no chaos spaces on a track, then you place it on the closest village space. And then follow the plot twist on the fate card. Also, chaos markers have an effect on player units' movement. Let's say this was empty. Only with chaos, a player unit moving into a chaos space have to stop its movement immediately, and for the rest of the turn it can take no further actions. It has to stay there. If a Zed's unit is in there, of course a hand-to-hand combat takes place, and dependent if the unit is retreats. Retreating is still allowed, it's not an action, so it can retreat. It's no longer in a chaos space, so it can continue performing actions. But if it moves in there and the Z's unit retreats, it's in a chaos space, and the only thing it can do is retreat and defend. In the housekeeping phase, remember the housekeeping phase ends after you performed your last action and finished the player action phase. There is a new step. The first step was to flip the action markers back to their action side. And then we have a second step. This is in all spaces where there's a chaos marker and a player unit, remove the chaos marker. This is called restore order. Place it in the pool, but increase infection by one per chaos marker removed. From then on, for the next turn, this unit is no longer in a chaos space, so it can perform any action as usual. Now let's talk about villagers and refugees. There are 5 villagers markers in the game. In each village, there was one here. We just removed it for demonstration purposes. And there's also a villagers help card. There's not much on there because villagers actually are defiantly staying there. They cannot do anything until they are flipped over to the refugee side. When a Z's unit enters a village space, we remember the defiant marker of the civilians is removed. And let's say they fight a hand-to-hand combat, both take some damage. One for the civilians and 2 for the Zeds, and the Zeds lost, they retreat. Nothing happens. The civilians can now act like any other unit, but the villagers still stay in there. As soon as the Zeds unit ends its movement and stays in the space with villagers, without any other unit protecting them, so let's say we had another hand-to-hand combat, but this time the Z's unit won the combat. The civilians took another 1-2 damage and had to retreat. Now the villagers are alone with the Z's unit. And this is the time where the villagers turn to refugees and immediately move one space towards town center. That's the procedure. This also can happen without any civilians in the space. So let's say we have this situation. So the villagers are still villagers staying in there. The Z's unit moves in there and it ends its movement in a space with villagers. So they turn to refugees, fleeing, and immediately retreat one space towards town center. Flip over the reference card to see how refugees act. First of all, refugees cannot take any actions except for move. And they move one space only. So on your turn, you can move them for one action. Also, they don't have any stacking limit. So usually you can only have 2 units on a space, but refugees and villagers don't have any stacking limit, so there can be as many as you want, plus 2 other player units. Once refugees make it into town center, first of all, infection increases by 1, and then place them into the refugee camp. There you can keep them till the end of the game, and they make your victory more valuable. There are background stories and points dependent on how many refugees you saved. But you can also equip them and send them back into the battle as civilians. So how does that work? During the action phase, you can use the equip refugees action. This is a free action. It doesn't use up any player action or event action. Just flip over the marker, remove a refugees counter to the cemetery, and take any regular civilians units from the cemetery and place it in town center instead, but on its reduced side. Equipping refugees can only be done once per turn. That's why you have your action marker here. And of course, this one is flipped back to the front in the housekeeping phase. As mentioned before, refugees cannot fight. They cannot really defend. So when a Zed's unit moves into the space with unprotected refugees, meaning only refugees, no other player units there, then they are immediately devoured. No hand-to-hand combat, nothing. They just are eaten or almost eaten. This increases infection by 2. Remember, 2, not 1. And they get a regular saving roll, meaning that on a 4-5-6, they are in hospital with an EKG marker. And on 1-2-3, they go to the cemetery. Of course, when they're in the hospital, they can be healed by a healing action. And then, with a discharge action, can be placed to the town center, where they immediately go to the refugee camp. One thing to add here, I said refugees can only move and retreat, that's true, so they also cannot restore order, meaning they will not remove the chaos marker at the end of the turn in the housekeeping phase. There's a special VIP survivor unit, it looks like this, it also has its own reference card, which comes in through a fate card. Probably, if you draw it, it usually arrives at the Star Trek of a space, and it is treated exactly like refugees. So they get a saving roll, they don't restore order, they have no stacking limit, and you can only move them one space. But they work a bit different. When they enter the town center, you can choose one of three benefits. A, reset infection to 0. B, heal all player units to full health that are on the board, of course not in the cemetery, or immediately take 4 supplies and 2 ammunition. You can choose one if you can guide them to the town center and then place them in the refugees camp, and they'll also count towards your victory. Now let's talk about the 4R phase. The 4R phase is the first phase in the game now. Okay, you draw an event card and then work yourself from left to right. This time we won't skip any phase. First is 4R phase. 4R stands for Raiders, Rangers, Refugees, and Rescuers. Let's talk about those guys. The Raiders unit, that is this unit, usually appears due to a card draw. So you might have games where they not appear at all, but they can appear. And usually they appear on the start of a track. During the 4R phase, the first step is have a look if there are radar units on the board and move it one space towards town center. Radar units don't belong to anyone. They're not player controlled, they're not sales controlled, they're just fight everyone in its way. Meaning that if they enter a space with a Zed's unit, it will be treated like a regular hand-to-hand combat. This means first infection increases and then there's a hand-to-hand combat. Look up the strength, compare the strength. In this case, it would be equal strength and apply hits and retreats. Let's say they moved here, they won against the Zeds, so the Zeds took some damage and retreated. If they move into a space with a player unit, they also attack. In this case, on the hand-to-hand combat, treat them like a Zeds unit when comparing and when determining the column to roll on. So this would be 6 against strength of 2, that would be the x3 column. But since the civilians are in a village space, there's a 1 shift to the right, a terrain shift. So the raiders move in here, there will be no infection increase because there are actually no Zeds. Just for the purpose of rolling on the table, they're treated like Zeds. And they will fight the unit. Whatever unit is the defending unit, in this case the civilians, will get the defense bonus of the space. Let's say it was the other way around. They're already here. Forget this for a second. They're already here and the civilians move in there. Still, it's a fight. It's a hand-to-hand fight. But the terrain shift is in favor for the Raiders unit. Raiders do not attack villagers or refugees. And also they have no stacking limit. They're just individual units and don't count towards any stacking limit. So actually what raiders are doing is they just move forward fighting anything in their way. And when they make it to town center, you have to reduce supplies and ammo in any combination by their current strength, which can be either 6 or, if they're already damaged on their weak side, 3. After that, remove them from the game. Keep in mind, raiders move independent of this number. This number is only for refugees. I'll explain this a bit later. Now let's get to the rangers. The rangers look like this. This is a pretty good unit. Once you have them in the game, you don't want to lose them because they can do a pretty good job. So, again, rangers might appear due to a card drawn, and usually they appear at the start of any track, let's say this track. Rangers are player controlled, so you can more or less activate them as any other unit. They can take 4 hits. They can move 3, they get a 1 shift in hand-to-hand combat, no matter if defending or attacking. They have long range, meaning they can shoot 2 spaces with -1 shift on the gunfire attack table, but they can also move in the 4R phase. So after any raider movement, you can move the rangers 1 space in any direction, so towards town center or away. They have the normal stacking limit, so a maximum of 2 units in a space, including the rangers. They also restore order, but only at the end of the turn. So if they move there during the 4R phase, you cannot do anything with them except for defending and retreating, and they will restore order in the housekeeping phase after the action phase. When they move into the space with a Zeds unit, even if this is in the 4R phase, immediately perform a hand-to-hand combat with the normal rules. So increase infection by 1, they get a +1 shift, a shift to the right in hand-to-hand combat, and they're pretty strong. Since they usually move from a start space towards town center or wherever you want to have them, the retreat directions are a bit different. When they are attacking, they retreat to the space where they came from. So in this case, if I'd attack here, lose, take a wound, then they would retreat back to the space where they came from. When they are defending against that unit, as any other player unit, they retreat towards town center. Now the third R in the 4R phase is refugees. We already talked about refugees, but they will probably also move in the 4R phase, and this is what the number is for. Refugees always only move 1 space. The number here shows how many units you have to move. So this is 1, so just select 1 of your refugee units and move it 1 space towards town center. This can be confusing and is a source for mistakes. If there is, let's say, a 2 or a 3, it doesn't mean that 1 unit moves 2 or 3 spaces, but that 2 or 3 units each can move or must move 1 space. refugee units must move, but you have a choice which one to use, and they don't have to move if they would enter a space with the Zs. Now let's have a look at the National Guards. There's also a card. Remember the 10th card from the bottom of this deck is the National Guard arrives. Immediately make a fate draw. Let's just do that live here. Make a fate draw and place a National Guard unit on the fated track start space. This is the highway track. So it's here. Remember, the start space is a conflict-free zone, so no hand-to-hand combat is here. Also remember, after placing, you have to resolve the plot twist. I won't do that at the moment. During 4R phase, as the 4th R rescuers, the National Guards will automatically move one space towards town center. They're actually pretty similar to the Rangers. The Rangers, there you can choose which direction to move. The National Guard, of course, will always move one space towards town center. Also, as an action in the player actions phase, you can move them an additional space in any direction. They have a stacking limit, meaning they apply to the stacking limit a maximum of 2 player units, including the National Guard. They are pretty strong, strength 10, and they can take 6 damage. So 1-2 damages, and the third one flips them over to 6, and then another 3, and then they are lost. So they are pretty good to clean up their way towards town center. They're pretty wasteful with their ammunition, so if you perform any gunfire attack with them, it needs 2 ammunition. And they cannot use the super weapon if you developed it. This is for later in the game. They can only use it once they arrived in town or town center. The retreat directions are exactly the same as for the Rangers. When they defend, they retreat towards town center. When they attack, they retreat towards the space where they came from. So actually, you will see the National Guard crawling along this track, and hopefully they can help you on their way, slashing some Zeds and defend the town center. Better hope than not die on their way. That was the 4R phase. Usually you won't cover all 4 R's, but just go through them in this order: Raiders, Rangers, Refugees, and the National Guard, the Rescuers. Let's talk about barricades. Barricades look like this. And barricades can be built by any player unit on their space. This costs 1 action and 2 supplies. Let's say those civilians here spend an action, 2 supplies, and place the barricade marker in their space. Remember, even defiant civilians, the only thing they cannot do is move, so they could also build a barricade, which can be pretty helpful at the start of the game. A barricade gives a +2 terrain shift, so a terrain shift 2 to the right. Remember that terrain shifts themselves do not stack, so if I build this here on a village space that already has 1 terrain shift, the total terrain shift is only 2. All other non-terrain shifts are on top of it. There can only be 1 barricade per track. You cannot build a second one when there's already a barricade on a track. So once it's here, let's just place it like this so you can see it. You cannot build a barricade on any other space. You can build it on any space. It doesn't have to be a namespace, wherever you want. You cannot voluntarily remove a barricade. But if Zed's unit leaves a space with a barricade, then the barricade is removed. Leaving means voluntary leaving. retreating does not count. If it retreats out of this space, the barricade stays here. But let's say we have another track activation and they just move one space, the barricade is removed. You have to build it again, but now you can build it on any space again of this track because there's no other barricade on there. There are 5 barricade markers in the game, so one for each track, 1, 2, 3, 4, and later on the tunnel track on the other side. So you can build a barricade on each track if you want to. There is a special kind of barricade called a strong point. This can only be built by Connell Kingman. And he can build it. Let's place him somewhere here, because that's already a dangerous track, for one action and 1, 2, 3 supplies. He can build a strong point. On the original marker, there will be the sign for a terrain shift of 3. So that's a 3 terrain shift, which is very powerful. Plus, the strong point marker will never be removed. Even if a Zed's unit is there and leaves the space, the strong point marker stays there. But in terms of track limit, it counts towards barricades, so there can never be more than one barricade or strong point on a track. You cannot build a strong point when there's already a barricade on the track, and vice versa. Also, Kingman comes with this minefield marker. For one action, let's say he's here, for one action, 2 supplies, 1, 2, and 1 ammunition. That's quite expensive, but it's worth it. 2 supplies, 1 ammunition. He can build his minefield on his space. The strong side shows a 7, the weak side shows a 4. The first time a Zed's unit moves into a space with a minefield, immediately make a gunfire attack. So actually the minefield explodes and it does make a gunfire attack with strength 7. So look at the gunfire table, 7 or 7 plus, roll 2 dice. That's a 9, that's 3 hits. 1, 2, 3 for the Zed's unit. After that, flip the marker over. So the next unit that enters the space suffers a gunfire attack on the 4 column, and after that the marker is removed. It can only be placed once per game. So there's one more event to cover that might show up or not. This is a fate card and is called The Bridge Collapses, which means exactly that the Farmingdale Suspension Bridge collapses, and you'll place the collapsed bridge marker on it. This means that no player units or radar units can enter that space. It's just, well, a broken bridge and you cannot pass through it. Zeds can pass through it, I guess they just walk through the water. You have to spend one action, and for one action you can flip it to the ferry side, so actually you can try to set up a ferry, which means that you can step on the space, but you have to end your movement there, meaning you have to take some time to take the ferry, and you have to spend another movement action to just continue your movement. If you happen to have Bob Bauer's crew as heroic civilians in your team, then you're lucky, because their special ability is that they can repair the Farmingdale Bridge. So that's the only unit that can remove the marker, so the space is free again and you can pass through it as before. So that's the new stuff for Level 2 Apocalypse. Just a quick summary. All green cards are in there. There's a new setup for the event deck. The National Guard card is the 10th from the bottom. Add 10 chaos markers to the game and add the villagers to the villages. Chaos is placed as soon as Zed's unit ends his movement in a named space, and at the end of its movement a chaos marker is placed. If you have to place a chaos marker and there is none over, so 10 on the board, you have to place the 11th one, you immediately lose the game. Also, during outbreak, check for the closest chaos marker on the track, and this is where a new Zets unit is placed. Only if there is no chaos marker, place them in the closest village space. If you move into a place with chaos marker, you cannot do anything. You have to stop movement and cannot perform any other actions than defending or retreating. And during housekeeping phase, remove chaos marker, increase infection by 1. Return chaos marker to the pool. Refugees enter the play as villagers in the villagers' spaces. They are defiant, they won't move or do anything there. They don't count towards stacking limit, so they are in addition to the two player units that can be on a space. If a Zets unit moves into a space with a villager unit and at the end of his movement or possible hand-to-hand combat, let's say these guys retreat, the villagers are alone in a space with a Zets unit, they turn to refugees and immediately retreat 1 space. Refugees cannot do anything except for moving 1 space. You can move them in the action phase by spending an action and moving them 1 space. And also in the 4R phase, when here is a number, this number shows how many units you have to select to move 1 space towards town center. Once a refugee's unit enters town center, infection increases by 1, they are placed in the refugee camp. And during action phase, once per action phase, 1 refugee unit from the refugee camp can be placed into the cemetery, and a unit from the cemetery, like this one, can be placed on the weak side back to town center. Refugee units attacked by Zets don't fight hand-to-hand combat. They immediately are devoured. Infection increases by 2, and they get a regular saving roll, ending in the cemetery or with an EKG marker in the hospital. The 4R phase stands for Raiders, Rangers, Refugees, and Rescuers. Raiders may appear. They automatically, independent of this number, move 1 space towards town center. They fight everything. They fight Zets, including increasing infection. They fight other player units. They restore order. And once they arrive in town center, you have to remove ammunition and or supplies equal to the number of the unit's strength, so 6 or 3, and then they are discarded from the game. Rangers are player units. In the 4R phase, you can move them 1 space in either direction. In the action phase, they can move 3 spaces following the regular movement rules. When they fight, they get a hand-to-hand combat shift of 1. And they can also make a long-range gunfire attack, so 2 spaces with a 1 shift to the left on the gunfire table. The refugees we already covered. The 4th R is the National Guard counter, which comes into play through the 10th card from the bottom, and it moves 1 space towards town center in the 4R phase and can be moved by 1 space in the action phase. They use up 2 supplies when making a gunfire attack, and they can only use super weapon effects once they arrived in town or town center. Barricades can be built by any player unit on their space. They cost 2 supplies to build and give a +2 terrain shift. There can only be 1 barricade on each track. It cannot be voluntarily removed, only if a Zets unit leaves the space other than retreating, then the barricade is destroyed and can be built for new. Kingman has a special barricade called Strongpoint. It costs 3 supplies, gives a 3 shift, and it will stay there until the end of the game. Also, there's a minefield he can build as an action for 2 supplies and 1 ammo, and it automatically attacks Zed's unit moving into the space with a gunfire attack of the strength of 7, then a flip over, next gunfire attack will be 4, and then the counter is removed from the game. That's it for level 2, the Apocalypse. Next tutorial will be level 3, Brains. Brains will introduce research, some more heroes, the science heroes, new cards, new fate cards, new event cards, Zed's antidote, and the super weapon. Stay tuned, see you then. Bye!